Hello, I am Ólafur Arnalds, and this is an in-depth video for Spitfire Audio about my track Brot, which is from my new album, which is called Remember. And we're doing this because this track I wrote wholly with the Ólafur Arnalds Chamber Evolutions Library. It was fully written with that and actually released 6 months ago on the Spitfire Audio website as a demo to promote the library. But then later I went into Air Studios and I recorded the track and mixed it with real musicians for the album. The track is called Brot, and I want to show you how I composed it, what I used to compose it, and then how I recorded it, why I recorded it, importantly, and then how we mixed it and finalized it. I've been writing this album for the last 1 year or so. It's a totally different thing from making music for television and film, because in television and film, you always have like a, you have like a box that you need to fit your music into. It's like you have the blueprint already for all the music. So just the only thing you have to think about really is to make music that fits into that box, you know? And it actually makes, it sounds like it's limiting you, but it's actually making life a lot easier because it limits the choices that you have while composing. Whereas making an album, you are starting with a completely blank slate. So you not only have to make the music, you also have to create the story around the music. And you have to somehow make that story, which should be in the music, you have to make it understandable and make it shine through all the music in the artwork and so on as well. So it's a little bit different approach. So just diving into the song, this song actually started with a beat, ironically. I had a co-producer for some tracks on the album. His name is Banger Boy, because he makes bangers. He's a hip-hop producer here in Iceland, and he's responsible for a lot of the kind of mainstream hip-hop hits here. And I felt like I was a little bit stuck in my sound, like where my sound was headed, like wasn't really going to new places. So I thought maybe I should call the most unlikely person to help me out. And we were here for a few months together in the studio, just composing and experimenting. And very often the story went kind of like this, that he would come up with a beat. That beat would influence something completely new from me, like in terms of sound and chord progressions and melodies. And then maybe I would just delete the beat at the end and just use his influence, but not actually use his beat. And this song was definitely one of those. So let me just show you first where we started. This is the beat he came up with. So he played this for a while, and I started doing these chords on top of it. I think that I was doing them on a synth originally, but slowly it moved on to this the Chamber Evolution Library. You can already see that, you know, the song is nice there. And for a long time, I thought this would be the song, like with this beat, with its chord progression. But turns out it had nowhere to go, like, because the beat is so busy, it's so heavy, and it's such a prominent part of the song, I couldn't really build it to anywhere. But I still finished like the bass line and the melody and everything on top of it. And then eventually I realized the only way for me to take the song someplace else is to not have the beat there at all, because that beat was just kind of tying us to that, you know, to that tempo, to that feeling, and we could never take the beat out. So I guess it's one of those songs that were, you know, apart from that beat, it was very influenced by the tools that I was using. The Chamber Evolution was still in this like alpha version at this point, so we didn't have this interface that you see on the screen here. The Spitfire guys had sent me individual patches for every sound. No, actually, this is even before that. I had the waves files from the recordings. So I was literally at the start working with just the recording files, the tracks, and I was editing each sample myself and cutting and pasting and copying. Then slowly, after a while, I was able to replace them with these real sample libraries here. And when I first got the waves, this was so inspiring to me that I could spend like hours and hours just playing those things. This is definitely one of these songs that just comes from that. So it starts with just some Evos. And this is like a nice mixture of these, what we call trills. You know, it's a mixture of tremolos and stuff like that, which are always my favorite part of the library and what I use the most. It's a mixture of that with a couple of more dissonant things. And that layer just goes on throughout the whole song. Provides like a little bed for everything. Then we start building the waves on top. And the way that the song develops is basically just the same chord progression in different kind of inversions, if you can call it that, kind of fading and morphing into each other. That's the second one that comes in, the third one that comes in. It's the same chord progression, but the melody turns slightly different. And as you can see, I'm just fading one out and replacing it with another one. And the song reaches its peak when all the basses come in. So at the end there, you have basically exactly the same thing you had in the beginning, but a couple of octaves lower, and the top melody has kind of reversed. So instead of going, you have them going exactly mirror that. So that's the structure of the song. It's very simple and just slowly morphs from one thing into another thing, which is actually basically the same thing. And the evolutions on top are doing the same. They're just kind of climbing down the octaves, starting very high up and ending up with a more low texturized feeling. At this point, probably some people are wondering, what the hell am I doing in Pro Tools with MIDI? I don't know the answer to that, but it's not as bad as people think, actually. I think it used to be really shit, but I got used to the shit version, and then it actually got really good. I think nowadays the MIDI in Pro Tools is very compatible with the other DAWs. Well, the difference is that it's all in the track. Like, I come from an engineering background. I used to be a sound engineer. I used to record bands in the studio before I was really working as a musician. So of course I got used to Pro Tools, which is the standard there. And then when I started composing, it made more sense for me to be able to compose in the track with clips, just as I would record with audio on the track with clips. It never made sense to me that I have to open another window to edit the MIDI. I love to just draw it directly into the track. That's why I've stuck with Pro Tools. I've tried to switch because people keep telling me that this is not the best way, but yeah, for me, it's working. So I'm using a lot of my favorite parts of the waves thing, which is these four last ones here. These are the extreme vibrato ones. And to give credit where credit is due, this is completely coming from Viktor Ori Arnason, who is my lead violinist on most of my recordings and most of my projects. I work with him very closely on these libraries, and this is very much his playing style that we wanted to sample. Because somehow his playing style through working with me has become my signature, even though I had nothing to do with it most of the time. But this is my favorite sound. It has this very shallow quality. He's playing, and in this case, the orchestra, the whole orchestra is playing very high up on the stick on the end of the violin, fretboard or something. So it creates this sultast sound, as we call it. And at the same time, he's doing a very fast but very shallow vibrato. So you get this ghostly, hollow sound. It's just absolutely wonderful. And the other thing I'm using very prominently here is a part of the Evo grid, and it's all these trills here, which is the blues section. You can always randomize with the trills, but I kind of pick my own here based on the texture that I would like to do. These are very good because they don't take up a lot of space, but yet they provide a lot of information in the high end of the spectrum, which often is missing, especially from sample libraries. You know, if you want live in your sound, you need that high end of the frequency spectrum to become alive, and these samples really give a lot of that. So it's very often really nice to just put these in the background of something that you're writing, and it provides this atmosphere, and it provides more life to everything. So I wrote this song actually as a Spitfire demo. when we were putting out the library, I gave this, you know, what you hear now with just the samples. This is what I gave to Spitfire, and it's actually on their website as a demo. About 2 days later, I realized this song fits perfectly on my album. So I want to put it there. So I didn't tell my record label about it, but this track, which is on my album, has technically been already released like 6 months ago. But I decided, you know, for the album, of course, I never end up with samples on the album. So I went and recorded it for the album. So we have these two different versions now around. One is on the Spitfire website, that's a demo, and that's using only samples. And then one is on my album as the album track. And for that one, I decided to go to London into Air Studios and record the track in the same studio with the same musicians who actually played on the sample library. And this was kind of an experiment as well to really see the difference, you know, between the samples and the actual played song. When you use the same studio and the same players, what is actually the difference? I kind of knew the answer to this before, but it's really nice to see that just black and white, you know, what changes. We spent 3 days recording the Chamber Evolutions library. And during these three very intense, beautiful days, actually, we spent so much time finessing the way of playing. You know, me and Victor, my lead violinist, we were talking with the band, we were playing with the band to find out these textures and these evos, so to speak, that are in the library, and really focusing on getting each one completely right. And I also just thought it would be was such an amazing thing to be able to go back to these players and say, okay, we spent 3 years basically practicing this. Now let's use it in a song. Now let's see how you can use the techniques that we developed together and actually use them to play melodies instead of just playing one note at a time. So yeah, we went to London, we went into Air, Victor was leading again. We had probably around 90% of the same people. We had the same engineer, Jake Jackson. In the end, what it really brings is still, even though no matter how good the samples are, they are still samples. You can't bring emotion into the samples on a scale, you know, like a sample is always one note at a time, but if you want to play three notes at a time, as a performer, you will realize, oh, the third note needs to be played slightly differently because of those two notes that came before it. The sample library does not know that. So that's one thing that changes. The dynamics of the playing serve a huge role, even with a simple piece like that, that is just built out of single notes that are played with silences in between. You still have that human feeling to it. I want to just do some comparisons here. Maybe first, let's listen to the Evo layer of the original, which sounds like this. Now let's listen to the same section, only the Evo layer of the final recording. So what's the difference here? I can't really say that one is better than the other, but I can definitely say that in the recorded version, you hear a lot more of individual human beings. You can hear the breath, you can hear mistakes, which are not really in the samples that much, but these tiny little mistakes that just make the piece come alive. The mix is, of course, a bit different. You can hear more high-end because of the way that samples need to be noise-reduced. Actually, they lose a lot of high-end in the sampling process because if you layer, like that was a chord of, I don't know, five or six notes, each of those notes is a separate recording. So if you layer five recordings together, you have a lot of noise built up in the high-end, and therefore, samples by their nature, string samples especially, need to lose a lot of their high end, which you don't need when you record the whole band at the same time. So you get more clarity in the high end from the recording. But again, I can't say it's really better. It's just different. Now let's compare the waves part. So put everything in here. So these are the sampled waves. Let's start here. Pretty nice. And this is the recording of the exact same part. Here you can hear a lot of difference, and I realized why one part of that is. That's because of their reverb is missing, because the reverb, it's the same reverb channel for both the waves and the Evo, so you're actually hearing this without the reverb, so it misses a lot of the tail. But despite that, there's still a lot of difference. The sound's a lot smaller for some reason, you know. When you have the wave samples, in each sample you have maybe 6 to 8 players playing each note. We never used the whole orchestra at the same time. We did this thing that we're calling like tethering, or forgot what we came up with a silly word for it. But in order for the sample to sound more realistic, we never sampled the whole orchestra at the same time, but always just did like this weaving of sections. So for the lowest note, we would use maybe the cellos and the violas. And then we would use maybe second violas and second violins together, and so on. So that when you played a big chord, they would all sound like one orchestra. But despite that, if you have chords like I have here, which are maybe, you know, these are maybe 8 notes playing at the same time, you have 8 times 6 players. I'm really bad at math, but that's a lot of players. Whereas I recorded this with the same size band as we recorded the samples with, but in this case, the notes need to be divided onto the whole band. So we have 18 players, but each note is only played by 2. So we have 18 in total instead of like 36 players in total, or 42 players, or however that math works out. Let me know in the comments how bad I am at math. So again, it's not better or worse. It's definitely more human, it's more realistic. Maybe let's try to compare now the whole piece with each other. Library demo here. That and go on to the recorded. So the difference is the samples sound definitely bigger, but that's because in effect there's a lot more players on the samples than on the recording. The recording sounds more intimate in my ears. It sounds more human, it sounds more alive to me, which I think will always be the case with samples. Samples to me are for inspiration, they're for writing, and especially a library like this, the Chamber Evolutions, it was designed to inspire what you write, and it was designed to have an effect on how you create and what you create, and it definitely did that in this case. So in my eyes, it did its job. For me, it's never the intention to release a recording with the samples. They are there to help me compose, they are there as a tool. Rather than a replacement of real humans who have a job, which is to perform amazing performances for you. So let's talk a little bit about the mix here. It's a lot of channels, and as you can see, many of them are deactivated. These grayed out areas are deactivated. These are the closed mics. I didn't end up using any of them in this song because the song needed just more ambience. So we recorded the song in 2 layers. We did the Evos on 1 layer, this is all this, and then another layer is the waves. Fun fact, in the UK you're not really allowed to do that, which is a bit funny, but just so people don't think I'm cheating on the unions. You are allowed to do it if you do it in two different sessions. So if you're recording one session, we did the texture pass, and on the next day we did the waves pass. Then somehow it's fine. Every channel has a slight pro cue that boosts up like the low mids, especially on the waves, to give them that thickness. And we have a little bit of the high mids coming up as well to give it the more presence. But apart from that, I didn't really go much into each mic in detail. There's just the tiny little bits where I could hear resonance from each group, like the tree or the outriggers. They had different resonating frequencies that I tried to get out with a little bit of surgical EQing. But, you know, the maximum here is like 2 dB or 3 dB. So this is not much. This is just because how amazingly beautiful and perfect Air Studios sound. When you record in there, there's not really much you have to do afterwards. But a key thing here is like how you the level mix between the mics. This is a tree. Then we have the outriggers. This is a little bit wider. Also very important in the mix. We have the ambience mics. And we have mics up in the gallery, which is the choir seats above the room. This is just pure reverb. And then we have a couple of ribbon pairs. This is a stereo pair of RCA 44s, I think, in front. Gives the sound a lot of body. And these are ribbon close mics. We did use those, but we didn't use any of the condenser close mics in this song. So all of these together, and this is again just the wave section of the song, sound like this mixed. And on these master buses here, I put each mic section on a master bus, and on them I do a little bit more EQing than I do on the mics themselves. And then we send those again also into the reverbs. So all of them together sound like this. And we have a master bus here with the Pultec EQ. I always put at the end of any string bus just to kind of shape the final balance between the low frequencies and the high frequencies of the sound. As you can see, I'm actually often boosting and attenuating the same frequency by the same amount. But there's still a reason to do that because the Pultec actually phase shifts the frequency. So it can actually bring out more, like to somehow make like these bass frequencies more obvious, even though they're not really raising in volume. They just phase shift a little bit and stick out of the mix more. And I always boost a little bit of like 5K or 8K on the strings, depending on the recording. But again, to give it that high-end air, which I really need in my string recordings. So in here I use mainly two reverb. They're both hardware. It is this 246 machine. This is the actual machine. Here's a remote for it. This is one of the very first digital reverbs ever made. It has a really nice new algorithm for that time, but actually also includes the EMT 250 algorithm, which is the reverb that is kind of famous looking with the red handle. You see it in a UAD plugin. So in this reverb, I have both that reverb and the 256 algorithm. Then apart from that, I use also the EMT 240, which is actually in the corner over there. And here's the remote for that. And that's a plate reverb that was made after the EMT 140, which is the famous big wooden box This was meant to be the more mobile, compact version of that, and they made it also more isolated, so you can actually keep it in the same room as your monitors, whereas the 140 you had to keep in a separate room because there was no isolation in the box. The 240 sounds a bit more dark, so it's very suitable for like piano and strings. It gives everything an extra piece of warmth. The 240 sounds like this. I'm just gonna make it longer here. So in the longest setting, you have this really amazing tail. Completely plate. That's a bit too long, so now let's shorten it again. When I press these buttons, there's like these screws inside the reverb that they are kind of turning and tightening the springs that hold up the plate, so the plate moves less. That's actually what this is doing. So I use this one for the darker sound, and then the 246 over here I use for a more brighter It just freaked out on me. You know, these things can be a little bit of a pain in the ass, but I think it's all worth it. First of all, they keep breaking, but I think that's normal with like a 30-something-year-old digital machine or 40-year-old digital machine. It's normal that it has a few hiccups. And then, of course, you have to print everything. You have to record, you know, any reverb I want on a channel. I actually have to play through the song and record that reverb onto a track. As opposed to plugins, they just render in real time whenever you play or render the song. So all of this takes a lot of extra time, but definitely worth it. I mean, there's some fantastic software reverbs out there, but yeah, they don't really compare to the real thing. Same like samples and human players, basically. So there's one more thing I do here for thickening the sound, aside from reverb. I take the string section and through the EMT plate, I run it then through two space echoes at the same time. So we have a stereo space echo image. So just the reverb path I take into the space echoes and back into the computer. And it gives us these delayed reverb basically, but on tape, so it wobbles a little bit. So it gives the whole thing a very slight chorus effect. So all the reverbs together with the space echo sound like this. And that's it, really. But even after all of this, you know, I was missing something from my sampled version. So I did one last thing on the mix before I delivered it to mastering. And I cheated a slight bit and I added very little of the EvoGrid layer from the samples on top of the recorded EvoGrid layer. So we actually have it very low in the mix under there. Just for extra thickness, just to pretend I had a few more players. It raises a bit up for the crescendo of the song, but goes down again in the end. So just the recording and with the samples. There's actually quite a lot of the samples there in the middle. But they sound good. The song became, for me, a very important part of the album. It was actually kind of the missing piece. You know, I had a track order which didn't include this piece, and I always felt like there was a missing puzzle to it, you know. It needed that calm, serene, ambient piece to kind of give the album that sense of context, you know, to give it the contrast to the rest of the album. And yeah, this song became that missing piece of the puzzle that finally made me satisfied about the album as a whole. So I'm grateful for Spitfire to let me kind of back out from giving them the song as a demo, and I'm grateful for nobody telling my record label about it until now. So to wrap this up, let's listen to the whole track through as the final recorded version. Thank you very much.